International cybercrime experts say we're in the midst of a surge in the number of ransomware attacks. Patient data from the Waikato DHB was published on the dark web after the health board suffered a ransomware attack last month. But the FBI estimates thousands of businesses and organisations are targeted by similar attacks every day. It's Kurtis Minder's job to negotiate with hackers and try to retrieve digital information once organisations have been hacked. Kurtis is with us now live from Chicago. Thank you for being on Q&A. How much of a problem are ransomware attacks?
Yeah, I mean, over the last couple of years, we've seen a dramatic increase in the number of successful attacks. The impact to the businesses, as you've probably seen on the news, is pretty catastrophic. For the larger businesses that we've heard about, critical infrastructure, medical facilities, it can impact daily life. The ones that we don't hear about are the small to medium businesses, of which thousands are also being hit every day.
Who is responsible for these attacks?
There's a sort of a short list of organized, the media likes to call them gangs, but they're organized groups of hackers that implement most of the attacks. There are some lone actors as well, but most of them are implemented by these organized groups. Most of those groups are based in Russia or Eastern Europe.
Are they state-sponsored?
We don't know for sure about the state involvement. There are some theories that they may have some coordination between those actors, for example, on the FSB in Russia, maybe sharing information, sharing data. We do know that for the most part, Russia has offered some amnesty to these actors as long as they're not attacking Russian targets.
And what is the typical way in which a ransomware attack works?
Well, initially, the threat actors will gain access to the network, or they will buy access to the network. So there are other actors whose job it is just to simply get access to the network, and they sell that access back to the ransomware actors. So they either break in themselves or they buy the access. Once they're in the network, the first thing that they do is they take as much data as they can without being noticed out of the network and store it someplace, typically in the dark web. And then the next thing they do is they will implement encryption across the infrastructure of the victim, which will prevent them from being able to access their files and systems, causing outages, etc.
So when businesses and organizations have been hacked and the hackers are demanding a ransom, often those organizations come to you and your company, GroupSense. What is your strategy?
Well, we play a lot of roles in those scenarios. One is as sort of a consultant to the business. It is ultimately a business decision, and it does differ based on the victim's scenario. We advise them on what the potential outcomes would be. We have a lot of experience with the threat actor group, so we sort of know what's going to occur before it does. Typically, it's very script or transcript-based activity. And then ultimately, our strategy is to lower that price down to the lowest number possible to get the data retrieved.
Okay, so to be clear, you don't personally go and try and retrieve the data through clever computer programming. You actually end up negotiating with these hackers in many instances. And what is your strategy when you're negotiating?
Well, I mean, many of the traditional negotiation, strategies apply here. The trick is, one, this is usually happening over a dark web chat forum, so we cannot see them, we cannot read tone, body language, make eye contact. And then the second thing is we have to keep in mind that most of these actors speak English as a second language, so the words that you use are very, very important. And so over the year and a half or so that we've been involved in these, we've developed some pretty effective strategies. And we've built a database and sort of some intelligence around how these threat actors operate, and that helps us.
But ultimately, your advice to many organizations and businesses that have been targeted by these hacks is to pay a ransom.
I don't recommend paying the ransom. No, I like to leave that up to the business. That is a business decision. I do not want to pay these actors any more than the victims do. But in certain scenarios, like some of the ones I mentioned, critical infrastructure, healthcare, where people's lives may be at stake. And then if you go down to the small business level, where a small business owner might go out of business if they don't pay the ransom, and that's really the only two options that are on the table. Until there's a third option, this has to remain a tool in the toolbox. And if a company decides to employ that tool, That's what we do. We'll help them with that.
There have been some really high-profile examples of these attacks recently. Baltimore was attacked in 2019, as in the city of Baltimore. The hacker wanted $76,000, but instead the city spent $18 million on completely rebuilding their cities, their systems. When the Colonial Pipeline was attacked, the owner paid $5 million to free the data. Here in New Zealand, a district health board in Waikato was attacked, which had potential impacts on hundreds, if not thousands, of patients. Would you advise the health board to pay a ransom in that situation?
Like I said, I would not advise them to. I would leave that up to them. What I would bring to the table would be all of the intelligence and know-how that we have from doing this work to help them make that decision. And then if they decide to move forward, we would certainly help them. And it does sound like it's taking them a lot longer to clean up than they originally anticipated, so they could probably use some help.
Is it a binary decision, Kurtis? Is it either you pay the hackers or you completely rebuild the system?
Well, it's more complicated than that, even, because when I mentioned what the threat actors do as when they actually do the attack, they exfiltrate a lot of data. And what we've already seen with the DHB is that they've begun leaking that data. So there's also ancillary impact that you have to consider beyond just the interruption to service and operations. The employees, the constituents, the medical records that will be leaked are also something to consider.
Yeah, we're looking at some images now of some of the data from the Waikato DHB that has been leaked. It's important to note that we've been careful to make sure that no patient data has been published here. How can you trust the hackers if you are in a position where you say, OK, we're going to pay you some form of ransom in order for you to return our data? How do you know that they're actually going to keep their word?
Well, you don't. So, I mean, you're making a deal with someone who has no accountability. So that is something that we let the victims know when we work on every case. We sort of bookend the case in the very beginning. We let them know. And at the very end, before we do a transaction, we let them know that, look, there is no guarantee here. But the threat actor groups do have a history of honoring these ransoms. They do typically give you the decryptors when you pay. And as far as we can tell, in most cases, they do not dump the data if they agree not to dump the data.
At the moment in New Zealand, it is not illegal to pay hackers a ransom if your data has been targeted. But there's an argument to be made that if it were illegal, it might disincentivize hackers from targeting New Zealand organizations and businesses, knowing that they couldn't pay a ransom even if they wanted to. Do you have a position on the legality of paying a ransom?
I do. we've had similar conversations in the U.S. about this. My concern about that is that it is further punishing a victim. What I would like to see considered. So first and foremost, what we've learned by doing so many of these, taking inventory of how the threat actors have gained access to all of these systems and networks, most of the attacks are not sophisticated in nature and could have been prevented with some basic cyber hygiene. And so what I would propose to, and what I'm proposing here in the U.S. As often as I can and as loud as I can, is let's put together a comprehensive program to help with the prevention measures. And then if the attack is still successful, the cleanup measures, so that giving them that third option that I talked about, so that they don't have the option of go out of business, people die, or pay ransom. Third option is government helps me recover, right? And I think that's a better approach than simply making it illegal.
All right, Kurtis, thank you so much for your time and insights. We really appreciate it. That is Kurtis Minder.
My pleasure.
He is the CEO of GroupSense.